Grinding fine and coarse flour at Early Neolithic Göbekli Tepe. Cereals are one of the main components of the modern human diet. Their integration into the subsistence strategy during the late Epipaleolithic and pre-pottery Neolithic is a very long and complex process involving their selection and utilization, strategies of exploitation of land, the development of cultivation, and ways of processing and storing. Recent investigations have highlighted the area between the upper reaches of Euphrates and Tigris as one region where the transition to food-producing subsistence took place early during the Epipaleolithic and the pre-pottery Neolithic. The distribution area of the wild forms of einkorn, emmerich, barley, and other Neolithic fodder crops overlap here, and DNA fingerprinting has pinpointing the transitions of two wild wheat variants to domesticated crops to this part of the Fertile Crescent. The establishment of agricultural economies at the end of the later part of the pre-pottery Neolithic, comprising the deliberate large-scale cultivation of domesticated cereals and other domesticated plants, was predated by a longer period of experimentation and technological modification that led to the development of a specialized toolkit for plant and cereal food processing. My main research focus are the final products of cereal processing and their consumptions. Göbekli Tepe in southeastern Turkey is one of the sites in this region where this process can be followed, as it covers the whole period in question and a substantial part of it was excavated. The site is famous for its architecture, comprising monumental buildings from up to 4 meter high T-shaped pillars, which are positioned in 10 to 20 meter large round structures with two bigger pillars in the center. They are surrounded by rectangular buildings standing on the slope, which are partially contemporary to the round buildings. The experimental research was designed based on this site, as the impressive amount of work naturally raises questions regarding the subsistence of the builders because of the massive presence of grinding stones and of the special role of the site as a sub-regional meeting place in which possibly different foodways met. The reconstruction of the site's character and fine context is a very important part of the experimental design. There are several factors contributing to workload invested in the construction of the round buildings. They are monumental, multi-phase, and long-lived, and were permanently repaired, reconstructed, and changed. The pillars were richly decorated, they are not easy to transport. Work feasts, implying large-scale over-regional cooperation, were proposed a social mechanism enabling the construction process. As for the subsistence, archaeozoological analyses show the consumption of gazelle and arrow's meat. Macro-rest of plants hinted the consumption of cereals, einkorn and barley, and pulses too, but are not well preserved. Phytoliths, however, show a massive presence of possibly cultivated grasses at the site. The most numerous category of tools are grinding stones. More than 10,000 artifacts have been found and constitute one of the largest inventories in all Neolithic sites known from Southwest Asia so far. Traces of a permanent presence of hunter-gatherers, or better, foragers, at the site, until now come mainly from the partially later rectangular buildings situated around the monumental constructions. The fine context suggests that grinding of foodstuffs took place around the monumental buildings with a direct view toward these. Most grinding stones were placed initially on roofs and were relocated during the collapse of buildings and through erosion processes. The spectrum of their shapes is diverse and comprises several forms of active tools like handstones and pestles used on netherstones, especially large querns, plates, and mortars, with different deformations of the working face. All were made mostly of basaltic stones. The experimental program presented here is focused on the handstones, which are the most frequent category, comprising almost 4,000 species. The analysis of shape and haptic was the first step in studying their functions. This type, which is one-handed oval to sub-rectangular in top view and has a high and square or oval-shaped section, is the most frequent and constitutes the focus of this experimental program. The actual shape is a result both of preform and changes through use. The surface mirrors only the last use. No blanks are known at the site, but the blocks in the nearby quarries offer information which helps to reconstruct the initial form. For the experiments, large blocks of basaltic lavas, with properties and pores similar to the archaeological finds, were split and shaped into similar blanks. Then, the blanks were shaped to imitate shapes and ways of the supposedly less used archaeological pieces through picking, the technique which is also attested on the originals. The experimental work was focused on the dry processing to fine and coarse flour of einkorn, as attested by the botanical rest. Both fine and coarse flour were produced in working units of 500 grams each. Working times, on the other side, are non-controllable variables because they depend on the physical condition of the participants, environmental and other external factors. They were measured but not used in calculation. I worked with already dehusked einkorn with 70% whole grains, as dehusking was done at Göbekli Tepe separately in special hollowed bowls through pounding. Protocols comprise information of participants, products, working times, environment and weather condition, position of the body during work, as well as the handling of the handstones and the performance motions, both as descriptions and drawings. Each participant has to accomplish one task, either the production of fine and or coarse flour. Flour was considered fine when the particles were fine-poured, almost white-colored, predominantly smaller than 5 mm, and a light granulation was palpable. This flour was thicker when water was added, dough could be formed. Coarse flour was obtained by crushing the grain superficially into coarse particles of up to 2 mm. The flour was yellowish and not sticky when combined with water. Four sieves with different mesh sizes were used to separate the product, which was classified after at least 75% from the quantity have met the described criteria. Although the 11 participants were free to choose body position, haptic and handling, there was a significant tendency to prefer circular, oval and spiral motions for making coarse and bidirectional and pendular motions for the production of fine flour. Circular motion work with softer pressures and the processing of einkorn to coarse flour is much faster and not as tiring as the productions of fine flour. Coarse and fine flour production seems to correlate with different motions, which correspond to different surface deformation observable both macroscopical and microscopical. Clearly, there is a different disposition of flattening, representing the friction between handstone and the netherstone, and the typical flattening of the margin corresponds for the production of fine flour, while during the production of coarse flour, the center is more worn. The profiles of the high topography are predominantly sinuous when circular motions are used. Microscopical wear markers and deformation of shapes evolve differently too. The pendular motions are associated with the appearance of a fine striation network on the flattened margin. The problem of reconstruction of the original shapes was again approached by comparing preforms with salt blocks, which were then used in a separate experimental program, either with circular or with pendular motion. The formation of the flat margin during the production of fine flour with pendular motions can be followed through different stages of use. The emergence of this band as erosion can be visualized using 3D models and the deformations of the profiles on salt blocks. These types of profiles correlating with the flattened band on the margin and typical wear markers on the working faces were observed also in the original assemblage. The wedge shape is not an intentional tool design but a deformation in these cases. Putting all elements together, shape, surface deformation and microwear, it can be estimated that handstones with traces of the production of coarse flour of cereals through circular motions are dominant within the assemblage from Göbekli Tepe. This hypothesis also is confirmed by analyzing the deformations of the nether stones. feather stones with large oval deformations of the working face are clearly dominant in the assemblage. The problems in a general quantification of wear are the multifunctionality of the handstones on one side and the absence of the working faces in different stages of use, both in handstones and in leather stones on the other side. Toolkits of such grinding stones are often associated with stone vessels and large stone trough. Chemical analysis of the sediments inside vessels show the presence of cereals and their processing through heating to porridges or beer. This aspect was followed in a different experimental program. At the moment, we see evidence at Göbekli Tepe for cereals being intentionally processed in different ways. There clearly is early diversity in food processing techniques. Most probably, wet cooking prevailed, but bread-like products were also produced. Cooking of large quantities of porridge and probably of beer fit well in the previous modeling of social activities at the site, respectively work feast and commensal consumption. Thank you for your attention.